Good morning and welcome to St. John's. Please stand up with me. Whoever you are and wherever you are in life's journey, you are always welcome here. Let's sing.
Father, mighty God, you are creating. The cosmos cries a song of praise. Jesus, child of God, you are speaking words that heal and words that save. Spirit, move on the deep. You are breathing light and life to empty space. Even here, even now, join the crowd, gathered round, sing along, glory song. Hear the sweet sounds surround. Cries a song of praise. Jesus, child of God, you are speaking words that heal and words that save. Spirit, move on the deep. You are breathing light and life to
source of leadership and support today. I want to lift up Dan. I want to lift up Marla. I want to lift up Mary. I want to lift up Steve. I want to lift up Hank. We could not have done today without an incredibly strong team. And I'm going to go back and mic up. Hank is preaching today. So we like to tell people, if you don't like the fact that we have a female pastor, our gay seminarians are going to preach today. So, right? So if you are new to us, if you are just coming for worship right now, you may not know that this morning we were picketed by Westboro Baptist Church, which is full of hate. They come in from out of town. They spread their poison of hate. And we very quickly organized a peaceful witness to love. We could not have done it without a strong team, a strong church, and the strength of our community. The interfaith community showed up in support. We had more than 130 people outside the front of this church in support of what we're doing here, as well as in support of our sister church, Trinity Lutheran, as we migrated down there, protected their space with love as the protesters targeted them, and then we came back here. So I really, really want to thank all of you who are here today. Would you raise your hand if you helped participate this morning, and would you all give everybody a round of applause? Give yourself a round of applause. Give yes. I've only had a moment to briefly look at all the Facebook Live and pictures that are posted. Please post that stuff and share it widely. Let people know what we're doing here in the city of Columbus. What we're doing is extraordinary. Hate will not win. Love will overcome. Faith, hope, and love, these three, but the greatest of these is love, correct? So I want to invite all of you to greet one another. If you are new to us today, that's how we warmly welcome everyone, no exceptions. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please greet one another with words of welcome and the peace of God.
Please join me for the call to worship. Welcome to the house of the divine creator who loves us all. We are all invited, all ages, all races, all genders, all sexual orientations, all who are rich or poor, healthy or sick, citizen or immigrant. All means all. We are gathered, we are ready. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
the reading of Scripture? Oh, have, just kidding. Do you?
We have an invocation. We're going to pray, and then you're going to read.
Pray on.
We'll all read together the invocation printed on the screen. Okay. Holy One, who dwells in, among, and around us, sustainer of life and enveloping spirit of hope and love, we ask that your presence be with us now as we gather in this place. We accept your invitation to fellowship with you and welcome all who are among us to share in the abundant blessings you have bestowed. Amen.
And now, a reading from the book of Psalms, the 112th chapter. Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in God's commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. They are not afraid of evil things. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. Their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid. In the end, they will look in triumph on their foes. They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honor. The wicked see it and are angry. They gnash their teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked comes to nothing. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
The New Testament lesson for today is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verses 1 through 8, and verse 15 through 16. Let mutual love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitalities to strangers, for by doing that, some have entertained angels without knowing it. Remember those who are in prison as though you were in prison with them, those who are being tortured as though you yourselves were being tortured. Let marriage be held in honor by all, and let the marriage bed be kept undefiled, for God will judge fornicators and adulterers. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me? Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Through him, then, let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that confess his name. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Would the children come forward, please? Well, welcome back. Where have you been, Clarks? We missed you. Have a seat. You've been camping and traveling and moving and doing what else this summer? Is that pretty much it? Camp. Being what? Being lazy. Anybody else? Guilty. So hi, you too. Yeah, you've been gone for a while too. Welcome back. And Ella's back. So we are at a special Sunday today. Who can tell just by kind of eyeballing up here what today is? Today is Communion Sunday. So what do you know about communion? Who's got something? What do you know?
Somebody holds the bread. Somebody holds the juice.
Yes.
Yeah. Everybody makes two lines.
Right.
One going this way, one going this way.
Yep.
Hold the bread out. People take the bread. You say, body of Christ. People walk over to the juice. Dip the bread in the juice. Person holding the juice says, blood of Christ.
Yep.
And then they eat it.
Yes.
Children's sermon over. That was excellent. You got it. You got it. You got it. So why do we do this? Who did it first? Why do we do communion? Who did it first?
Jesus.
Jesus did it first, and that's why we do it. So I learned in seminary. Are there any adult students in the room who are kind of going back to school after a little bit? Yes, right there. Okay, tip for you. Okay, because you're going to seminary. Yes, that's so exciting. So I learned in seminary very early on that if you have your kids illustrate your projects, you get an extra grade. It like lifts the whole thing up to a new level of awesomeness. So this is a book, and I believe it's scanned, that I did back in seminary. My daughter illustrated it. I think she was 7 or 8, something like that. It's called One Loaf of Bread. We'll just read it off the screen. I have the book here, but it's also up there. So let's go. One loaf of bread, all crusty and brown. Two doors to enter and gather around. Three little blankets over juice, over bread. Four hands lifted up while thanksgivings are said. Five candles lit to help us remember. Six in my pew, all singing together. Seven bags of food for those called the least. Eight steps lead up to the wonderful feast. Nine rows of people, young and old, black and white. And then Spencer's hands, 10 fingers, taking communion tonight. The end. So all those great parts of communion. Now you said everybody lines up in 2 rows. Now really everybody? Everybody? What about like little bitty kids? I don't know. What do you think? Do you think Jesus would give them communion? Okay. What about people who are maybe from a different church? So all are welcome here. What about people who are different colors? Is that cool? Yeah. What about people who love somebody differently than we do? Is that cool? Are you rolling your eyes like, what's the big deal? I love kids. That's why I love kids. They're like, oh, whatever. You know, side story, when Obama was elected, my kids went to bed. I was like, where are you going? They're like, ah. I couldn't decide if that was good or bad. I decided finally that was good because they didn't care. They didn't care. It was good. I decided it was good. So communion is for everybody. This meal that Jesus shared with his friends is for everybody. Now, what about, here's the hard question. Ella was with us this morning at the protest. What about the people across the street? Is communion for them? It's a hard call because they were hateful. They were. They had signs and what do you think?
But doesn't God love all?
But doesn't God love them too? And does this table give them a chance to recognize that? And it welcomes all. And that is the best part of communion. So we will be back in for communion after Holy Moly. We're going to pray really quickly and count to three. One, two, three. Dear God, thank you for this table, for this welcome, for this church, and for this community. Help us to take this welcome out into the world. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's go.
A hurricane, I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how God loves us so. Oh, how God loves us. How God loves us so.
like a hurricane, I am a tree bending beneath the weight of her wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory,
morning.
Good morning.
So I am the gay seminarian that you all have heard so much about.
Yeah!
Been exposed to an awful lot. It's not contagious though, so that's okay. I am very happy to be here once again. Things changed a bit since I put what I was going to say together. I don't know how they changed, except for the fact that I had to set 3 alarms this morning, the first of which I slept through, the second of which I hit snooze and slept through the snooze, and the third one woke me up so that I could leave at 7:15 from Delaware, except I left at 7:35 from Delaware, to get down here because we had protesters that wanted to be hateful. But what an amazing sight that we had from our St. John's community, from the broader faith community here in Columbus, folks representing all sorts of faiths, not just Christianity, who were here in solidarity to say that God is love, and love always wins, no matter what. Today's sermon I titled An Open Invitation, which I guess is even more fitting now given what happened today than it was when I first sent the title to the powers that be earlier this week. Because I wanted to talk about the hospitality that God wants us to show to everyone, the hospitality that I and others of you have enjoyed here at St. John's, and the hospitality that surrounds Jesus' invitation to us at the communion table. An open invitation. Now, when I was a kid, especially like elementary school age, I used to get really upset at my mom because whenever my brother or I decided when we wanted to give out cards at school, like for Valentine's Day, that kind of thing, she made us give a card to everyone in the class. We weren't allowed to pick the kids that we didn't like or that wanted to like us. We had to give one to everyone, which was super annoying. But she thought it was important that no one feel left out. And she was right. And there were times when I got fewer Valentine's cards than other kids in my class, because obviously not all moms followed the same rule that my mom followed. And in retrospect, I'm very grateful for her requirement, because feeling acknowledged, feeling included, feeling seen is important. And our New Testament text today from the book of Hebrews is one that focuses on hospitality and building community. The book was written to address a group of Jewish converts who were living in Rome and was meant to provide comfort and guidance to them. They were a minority, an ethnic minority, and they were part of a cult. Let's not forget, Christianity started out as a cult. They were strangers in a strange land. Ethnically, religiously. Hospitality and welcoming strangers, though, are an important tenet in Judaism. And much of the Hebrew Bible consists of stories that revolve around or address hospitality in some way. So the theme of today's text would not be unfamiliar to those from a Jewish tradition, and they needed all the encouragement and reassurance that they could get. Hospitality, welcome. What does that look like? What is it supposed to look like if we're following the example and words given to us today and the words spoken by Jesus? The point that Jesus made time and again, the point that is made in today's text, is that the hospitality we are expected to show is not the same that the dominant culture would say is proper. Or at least that the hospitality we show is not to whom the dominant culture would say is worthy of that hospitality and welcome. If you were here on Pride Sunday in June, I had the honor of preaching that day. Wonderful. And that sermon was titled Authentically Vulnerable. The concepts of authenticity and vulnerability have been swimming around in my head. There's plenty of room to swim. Ever since then, and they've actually formed the core of two papers I've written for seminary so far, including one I wrote last week. And I don't think that's going to change. And as I continue to ponder how we can best build beloved communities that seek to build the kingdom of God, it seems to me that authenticity, vulnerability, and interconnectedness are all vital components. I would say that it's actually impossible for us as human beings and followers of the teachings of Jesus to practice true hospitality without incorporating all of those components. Authenticity, vulnerability, interconnectedness. All of them are required, I believe, if we are truly going to be welcoming as individuals, as a church, and as a broader human community. Authenticity is what gets people in the door and makes them stay long enough to check things out. Authenticity is why we have rainbow flags flying on our building. It's important that people who are driving down Mound Street or 3rd see those flags and they know that St. John's is a church where all truly means all. As someone who came from a religious tradition that said I was not worthy because of who I am, and I was not truly welcome even though they said I was welcome, I know some of you experienced the same thing. When we talk about being a beacon of hope in the heart of the city here at St. John's, those rainbow flags are the light on the top of the lighthouse for queer folks like me who are just going to give church maybe one more chance. Or for people like my parents who have a gay child or a trans grandchild, and they can no longer sit in the church they've been part of because their child or their grandchild is not fully accepted by that community. That's why we have those rainbow flags up all the time and not just at Pride. Symbols like that save lives. The folks coming together this morning to stand in witness in an opposition to hate that is supposedly in the name of God, that saves lives. I can guarantee you that folks driving by in those cars that this morning who saw us, whether they acknowledge us or not, some honked horns, some waved, some flashed the peace sign. They may have flashed another sign out the other side. We didn't see that. But even if they didn't seem to react at all, I can guarantee you that someone in one of those vehicles was touched and their life was changed because of the witness of the people from this church and from the broader community here in Columbus, and I am proud of that. We have saved lives, and we are continuing to save lives, and being authentic does that. Authenticity is those rainbow flags. Authenticity is why we have women in ordained ministry and in leadership roles. Authenticity is why you have a big old homo in the pulpit this morning. Authenticity is why we allow people to seek shelter in our breezeways and on our property. And that authenticity goes hand in hand with vulnerability. And I've tried to imagine whether it's possible to exist authentically without being vulnerable. And I don't think it's possible. I think they have to go together. True authenticity requires vulnerability. And true vulnerability requires authenticity. But vulnerability is hard. Vulnerability is preyed upon in our culture. Hebrews 13:2 tells us to show hospitality to strangers, people we don't know, people we might fear or others might tell us we are supposed to fear. Strangers aren't people that we just don't know. We create strangers in our heads every day. People who worship differently than we do, whether it be in style or to a different deity, or maybe people who don't worship at all. People who speak languages we don't understand. People who eat sushi with a fork. People who eat sushi. Now, if you like sushi, talk to me after the service, because I've been looking for some sushi. And I don't eat it with a fork. But hospitality paired with vulnerability means that we become humble enough to realize that our way of doing things is not the only way of doing things. Authentic vulnerability creates true hospitality because it requires us to show up and welcome others with truly open hearts and minds. Not just words, not just lip service. An interconnectedness is the third component, I believe, of showing true hospitality. And that is because you cannot create a community that is authentic and vulnerable without understanding that interconnectedness is what gives us strength. You've heard Pastor Jenny and me and others use the term kingdom of God. How many of you always heard kingdom of God before? It's in the Bible, but lots of us heard it in Sunday school and church. But there are two primary reasons why I like to say kingdom of God. First, it isn't specifically gendered. And I think that gender-neutral language is important and necessary when talking about God. God transcends gender. God is God, God is he, God is she, God is gay, God is trans, God is everything. God is transcendent. The kingdom of God. And second is that it connotes the kinship we all are supposed to share as human beings, our interconnectedness. Understanding and embracing that interconnectedness is needed if we are going to do true work towards establishing the kingdom of God here on earth. Existing in an authentically vulnerable state with each other in community requires that we are all interconnected. Sort of like the spokes on a bicycle wheel. They lean in different directions, working together to provide stability for the wheel. Each spoke on its own is thin and fragile, but together the spokes give that wheel strength. Now, on the first Sunday of the month, every month here at St. John's, we observe communion. Mary talked to the kids about that. It's a sacrament that we practice to remember Jesus' life-giving message and his invitation to all who wish to receive it. Communion is an act that incorporates authenticity, vulnerability, and interconnectedness. Many of you know, and I've shared this before, when I decided I was going to go back to church for real, visited several churches in LA before finding the UCC church I went to and joined in Altadena. And even before that, when I would come to visit my family, and my brother is a United Methodist minister. He pastored churches in Tennessee and then here in rural Ohio. There were times when I went to churches and they were serving communion and I did not partake because I knew that even though they said the invitation was open to everyone, they did not truly believe that I was included in that group. So when I found a church and when I visited my brother's church when he was a pastor and I knew that he accepted me for who I am, even if he couldn't say it officially in his capacity as pastor in the places he was, I did participate in communion because I knew that the people who were holding the cup, who were holding the bread, who were delivering the litany, believed in their hearts that that table was open for me and for every other person in that building. You had the choice whether or not to come, but there was nothing that you could do to be denied it. Didn't matter. And so today, when we celebrate communion, we are celebrating a community that is authentic. We are celebrating a community that is vulnerable. And we are celebrating a community that is interconnected. Because no matter where you are, who you are, where you've come from, what you believe, You are welcome. There are no qualifications. There are no exceptions. Let us all strive together to be authentically vulnerable, to become truly interconnected in community, and derive our strength from that, so that we can join our brothers and sisters who have no choice but to live authentically. I spoke about this on Pride Sunday. People who don't look like me, people who aren't white males, cisgender, people of color, people who are trans, people who speak different languages, people who speak with thick accents. They move through this world in an authentic way because that is who they are. I have the choice to decide whether I'm going to be authentic or not. And as a church and as a church community, we have the choice whether or not we're going to be authentic. I'm here because I think that St. John's pretty much gets it right. No place is perfect. Surprise. But I think that authenticity and that vulnerability is in our DNA. And I think as we are building a broader community, as we saw the folks who came out today, and this is fantastic. We're in the Midwest. To remind myself of that sometimes, because I've been pleasantly surprised by Columbus. I got lazy 15 years in Los Angeles. But let's strive to be authentically vulnerable and to draw comfort and strength from one another. Amen.
Well, we are reconfiguring a bit today because of everything that happened this morning. And again, would you all please give Hank another round of applause, because we really want to support his journey, his learning. He was scheduled to preach today, and then, of course, he's learning that that's what happens, is you may have a sermon well planned out and your topic well planned out, and then late on Friday you're going to get some news that's going to change your whole message. And that is what life and preaching and community and church is all about. But we are so grateful for each one of you. We are grateful for this morning. And as we bring our hearts together to give our offerings to God, we also prepare our hearts to receive communion. This is an open table, and the litany will be on the screen. If you're new to us, you will see booklets in the pew as well. And you're also welcome to just not say anything and just come forward and receive the elements when it's time. But at this time, as we prepare to receive our offering, I remind all of us that it is through our gifts that we are able to do the ministry that you saw publicly witnessed so profoundly outside this church this morning. And gracious, holy Creator God, you have shown us what mercy and love and hospitality look like. We saw it outside this morning. God, you have extended an invitation to all with no exceptions. May we open our hearts and minds as we provide gifts today that will sustain and model the radical hospitality that you have shown to us. Amen.
Thank you. We seek only your face. God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Christ, all people here below. Praise Holy Spirit evermore. Praise Triune God whom we adore.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. If you are new to us, our communion litany is printed on the screen and in booklets in your pews. We start first with a confession of sin, only to remind ourselves to be careful when we are evaluating situations and to be careful not to judge others. I'm always reminded about how if I remind myself that someone might be doing the very best they can in the circumstance in which they were raised or in which they are present, or in which they exist, that I have a different attitude toward them. Doesn't mean everything's okay, but if I remember that Fred Phelps' children and grandchildren who were present today were raised in such a culture of hate that they know nothing else, it helps me have an attitude of compassion towards them. Doesn't mean what they did was okay, but it helps me understand how important what we do is so they can see a different expression of church. So again, thank you today for all of your support. Thank you to Hank and our team and all of you who have made this place possible. But I remind myself that should we ever get too judgy about others, we first have to look at ourselves. So if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins before God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and follow in the ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The good news is that anyone in Christ becomes a new person altogether. The past is finished and gone. Everything has become fresh and new. When we confess our sins, it all becomes fresh and new, and we are pardoned. So friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Now Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. No one who comes to me will I drive away, even those protesters on the corner. Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do everything for the glory of God." Please stand as you are able. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God Most High. Please join me in the unison prayer of our faith. We give you thanks, God of majesty and mercy, for calling forth the creation and raising us from dust by the breath of your being. We bless you for the beauty and bounty of the earth and for the vision of the day when sharing by all will mean scarcity for none. We remember the covenant you made with your people, Israel, and we give you thanks for all our ancestors in faith. We rejoice that you call us to reconciliation with you and all people everywhere, and that you remain faithful to your covenant even when we are faithless. We rejoice that you call the entire human family to this table of sacrifice and victory. We come in remembrance and celebration of the gift of Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the good news. Born of Mary, our sister in faith, Christ lived among us to reveal the mystery of your word, to suffer and die on the cross for us, to be raised from death on the third day, and then to live in glory. We bless you, gracious God, for the presence of your Holy Spirit in the church you have gathered. With your sons and daughters of faith in all places and times, we praise you with joy. Please be seated. Now, on the night on which he was betrayed, on the night that Jesus had maybe his equivalent of protesters on the corner, on the night he had someone in his midst that was going to have him killed and he was going to have him betrayed, Jesus took the bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to all, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." And then likewise on that same night, Jesus took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he gave it to those gathered, saying, "Take, drink. This is my blood shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. The blood of the new covenant. As often as you drink this, do it in remembrance of me." Please join me in the affirmation of our faith printed on the screen. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. Holy One, show forth among us the presence of your life-giving word and Holy Spirit, to sanctify us and your entire church through these holy mysteries. Grant that all who share the communion of the body and blood of our risen Savior may be one in Jesus Christ. May we remain faithful in love and hope until the perfect feast with our exalted Savior in the eternal joy of your heavenly realm. Please join me. Gracious God, accept with favor this our sacrifice of praise, which we now present with these holy gifts. We offer to you ourselves, giving you thanks for the perfect offering of the only one begotten by you, Jesus Christ, our Savior, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be to you, eternal God, now and forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready for you. We practice an open communion table here at St. John's. We do this fairly informally because we want everyone to feel welcome at this table, whether you're young or older, whether you can walk fast or you have to walk slower, no matter what you are wearing, as long as you're wearing clothes, because all are welcome, but not anything goes, right? So we invite everyone to come forward, and you may begin coming forward now for communion, because this is an open table. You're invited to take a piece of the common bread and to dip it into the common cup and to make sure that everyone can partake. We also have a wheat-free, gluten-free offering over here with separate elements for those who may have dietary restrictions. We want them to make sure to be able to partake as well.
Eat this bread, drink this cup. Come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup. Trust in me and you will not thirst. Eat this bread, drink this cup. Come to me and never be hungry. Bread, drink this cup, trust in me and you will not bread, drink this cup, come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup, trust in me and you will not thirst. Bread, drink this cup, come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup, trust in me and you will not to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup. Trust in me and you will not thirst.
If you are new to us, we have a practice here at St. John's to conclude every communion service, and that is to rise from our pews and gather around the sanctuary and sing Live in Charity. So I invite you now to engage in this wonderfully freeing practice where we remember that communion is not just about us and God. It is also about us and neighbor. And I invite you as we sing to look into the faces of every individual, Hank, our preacher today, our pastors, Dan, Marla, Mary, Steve, our spouses, all of those who support the work of this church, and each of you without whom this church would not be possible. This is your community. Look around at these faces. You are not alone. And together, love will conquer hate with each of us. Thank you for being here today.
Go in peace to love and serve. The children will show you our high five benediction, which we haven't quite figured out how to do in the circle, right? But Addison is right here to help us do it. So may God bless you and give you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace while you go forth to live the gospel without exception. Give each other a high five, thanks be to God, and leave this place knowing that you are loved and welcome, and share that love with everyone. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen.
Accept it.